All right, so we're live. Just need to send out the word so everybody can join us. And okay, so the word is out. Gonna wait a few minutes to see if anyone wants to join in. And then, if not, we'll get started and people will trickle in. Or otherwise, well, it's gonna be a good night, a good and nice VOD in any case. Gonna post it in one of the game channels in case people miss it in general. Maybe get on the voice chat in case anyone wants to chime in before we get started. All right. So, let's get going then. And you know, whoever trickles in, trickles in. Let's just definite mute here. We can keep. Make sure we can see the stream chat. All right, thanks for waiting, everyone. So today I thought I would do some chill casts of some of the black tournament games. I thought I'd start pretty simple by casting some games from our homeboy Cranky Toaster, my good buddy. I know he likes being seen on the YouTubes, and he's been giving a pretty good performance in the tournament so far. So his first matches were against Rexed. And I think Rexed is maybe I think Rex might be more of a newer player. I wasn't sure if I was gonna feature him today, but he ended up giving a pretty good account of himself in the first game. So I thought it would be good to analyze the games, even if they're not as high level, just to see what we can learn from them or if we can have some fun. And yeah, the first thing that tipped me off is Rex's decks are a bit eccentric, to say the least. Some choices are pretty debatable, and some are just plain wrong, especially in his second deck. The first deck is interesting, but still a bit questionable at points. But hey, we're here to watch a game, so let's get started. On to the first match. So this is Cranky Toaster versus Rexed on Paddy Field. And Rexed is playing UK National, which is one of the more decent national decks. And Cranky is playing Baltic Front, which is one of his strong decks. He plays it a lot. And what is one of the top tier decks of the game. So, you know, he should be pretty fine with that. So this is the deployment. Just give me a second. I'm gonna grab something too. So on to the deployment. Let's actually begin with Cranky. So let's just give a few seconds for the units to split off. Okay. So what do we have here? We've got some spikes in the KRKK. Ito 90, some recon in the KT, probably either Sissi or Erikoi. Judging fine by the rank, actually, it's Sissi. Yeah, Erikoi would be hardened, or I would be veteran or elite, or the other one, whichever it is. Some infantry in the KT. Again, we're seeing probably Jagdpanzer and a whole bunch of Jekari 90 in the BTR 50. Super heavy start. Double super heavy start, actually. Oh, going full ham. The double super heavy start can be pretty good on Paddy, I'm fairly certain. Mortar. Some more recon. He has a fob. He started with a helo for his CV. Going light on the flank with an MI8 to maybe check out what's going on and defend this flank. As many people have mentioned, I tend to lose this flank to when I'm playing. But as people have mentioned, helicopters can be really good for defending this flank. I'm guessing if you park them somewhere around here, they can just murder everything that comes up the ramp. For a KT, actually, you'd probably want to be a bit closer somewhere around here so we can use it. So it can use its very balanced gun. And then for Rex, we have Saxon. Seems like Fusilier in the Saxon. Again, very interesting to start. Stormer, very standard. Chieftain, Mark 11. Yeah, that's basically the medium tank UK has available to them. Either that, or you could also use the Challenger 1 if you want a medium tank. Chieftain Mark 2 as like a fire support light tank. Man pads, Milan on this side, some more fusiliers in Saxon, some elite troops in Stalwart. Interesting. I'm guessing what's their name? Commando Marine? No, Royal Marine, Royal Commando, something like that. Special Forces is my guess. Unless it's upvetted infantry, but no, I think it's Special Forces. Some more man pads. Maybe going a bit too crazy on the man pads. A ferret starting off in the back, doing I don't know what. Some infantry in the links. This is the Badlings, though. Probably wanna upgrade that to the AH7 for the Snebs. But maybe gonna do some cheeky drops. Another cheeky drop here. Unloaded the infantry CV, that's good. Chieftain Mark 2. And Stalwart with some recon. I'd really like to see some more Saxons. Saxon is just like a straight up better vehicle than the Stalwart. So unless you're really, really stuck with it, you should probably do something else. So let's. Oh, and Lynx 3. Very interesting opener. Lynx 3 is kind of like a. I guess you could say it's kind of a budget tiger. It's got medium vision. That's pretty decent. It's got really good ATGMs. That's its main draw. Semi-assisted, so it's not as deadly as say the longbow, but it's much cheaper than a longbow. And the Stinger can allow it to skirmish and hunt down other helos. So I'm not against opening with the Lynx 3. I don't know if it's the best, but it's certainly interesting. So we're coming on here. Got a some infantry getting transported and eliminated by the Lynx. The Lynx is really, really quick to aim. So we just lost some recon here for Cranky. Immediately calling some AA. Good call. And the fight is started. I've heard some missiles getting fired, but I've no idea where they came from. Got the Milan 2 here. Chieftain Mark 1, Chieftain Mark 2. I know. Those we know where they're coming from. So, Rex is obviously completely overwhelmed here. That said, the 72, the T-72 M1 mods might be caught unaware. And here we have a Harrier GR7 which is a fire and forget rocket plane. Interesting. We don't see that one used very often. How effective is this gonna be? So we've got a already we already ate an ATGM. The 72 M1 mod has 21 front armor. Yeah, so that makes sense. It's gonna eat a second one. So I reckon it's gonna have lost 8 HP from that. And seems like the missiles did a bit. Of course, the best thing that the missiles did, the rockets did, was stunning the mods. That was actually a pretty good stun. And now it's panicked. Eidolon takes down the Lynx 3. Lynx 3 pretty much paid for itself. That seems like a pretty good trade. There was probably some way of saving it, but this is actually a pretty good position to harass enemy tanks because the line of sight can get blocked by the forest here, and the angles can get a bit wonky, especially if you low hover and you shoot here like that. So the remnants of their forces, but here on the right side we have Rex going full ham with a bunch of Royal Marines. So those were Royal Marines that we saw. Saxon stalwart. That's why you want Saxons and not stalwarts, because then they can provide some fire support. But three Royal Marines that can be really annoying to deal with in the woods here. We're gonna have to see how Cranky reacts. We've got the Lynxes circling around. Going to check if they can have some sneaking. And yeah, we missed it, but there was an attempt at sneaking and a helo in the back by Cranky, and the helo ended up trading with a Stormer. I remember seeing that when I did a quick check of the replay. So trading for Stormer, that was really close. I'd like Rex to see Rex react by calling some base defense, because he has none. But I don't think he'll be punished for it, at least. So we've got some Royal Marines taking down a KT. Gotta be careful with your helos. They can be taken out by infantry really quickly if you're not careful, especially special forces with the mini-me to boot. So Rex taking this position here. We've got Cranky preparing to move out with his forces here. So now that he controls the triangle bush, since he hasn't seen many forces from Rex here, he could go for this bush here, or he could go for the more prudent play of taking the square forest here. You can go for both, of course, because they're pretty lightly defended. This is probably what's gonna win him the match for sure. So we've got a KT getting caught in the woods by some paratroopers. Paratroopers eliminating them, getting a nice chevron from that. Got the Royal Marines spreading out. I'd really like to see Rex sending some reinforcements to fortify his push. Right now, he seems to be uncertain what he wants to call. So he's calling in his Sultan. Interesting choice of a CV, but he's calling a CV here to stop Cranky's ticking. Nothing wrong with that. Calling in some more Fusiliers. I'm not sure what Fusiliers will do for him now. He can park them in the town to maybe like hold the position. As same thing for the chieftain here. He's got a ferret, so he can do some interdiction against any tanks that might try to walk in here. Although the ferret is going to be pretty ineffective against the M1 mod because it's got only one more AP than it's got armor, so it would do what, 1.5 damage? 2 damage? Not a lot of damage. Not enough that the M1 can't just walk up to it and shoot it down once it's spotted. So we've got the Chieftain Mark II dealing very well with that infantry squad. The Chieftain Mark II is actually a pretty good fire support tank. It's basically a T-72. That's 10 points cheaper and just all around better. I think it's got the same front armor. It's got a slightly better gun, I think. Same HE power, but more AP. and it's just all around a really, really good fire support tank. You don't see it used that often in Commonwealth, mostly because Commonwealth, I guess, has already other fire support choices, and they also tend to prefer. Oh, and we have the paratrooper sniping Cranky's CV. Seems like Cranky didn't spot that his helo got taken out in the woods, so he didn't react by setting defenders. So this is gonna cost him quite a bit. Sending some Yikari to try and take control of this position back. If Rext had sent some reinforcements and fortified this position, the Yikari here would be insufficient to take back much of anything. So this is a pretty weak attempt at retaking the position. I'd like Cranky to maybe send that with a bit more support. His attention seems to be divided right now. So he's hunting down these paratroopers here. Seems like those other paratroopers got spotted and killed, probably by the BMP-1 KT. Yeah, Dimitri. Well, I wouldn't say the game isn't. The game is can't be saved by the blue player, but as you can see, it's probably Rex is probably a newer player, so the chances of pulling a surprise win out of his hat are pretty slim. I think right now he's betting on getting back into the match with a CV snipe, which would explain why he's going for that MLRS call. Normally, when you're behind that way, in such a way, you probably don't want to go for a CV snipes with artillery. You're basically just sinking a lot of points in a gamble that you might be able to kill the enemy's CV. And especially in the case of the M270, since it's an AP, it's a cluster MLRS, it can only kill vehicle CVs. It's gonna do no damage to infantry CVs. Oh, it's Kami. Oh, hey there, Kami. And yeah, I don't know why he put a marker here, but then decided to shoot here. If there was a CV here, a vehicle CV here, it would probably be dead. But Cranky has an infantry CV. One good thing to note when playing against Baltic Front is to make a mental note of whether or not you see an MI-17 in the opener. Very often, the only MI-17 Baltic Front decks will run would be with their CV. Otherwise, they'll have the KT as their attack helicopter of choice in the helo tab, and their all of their favorite recon infantry can't be taken in the MI-17. You can't take the CC nor the Iroquois in the MI-17. So if you see an MI-17 from Baltic Front, there's a good chance the opponent went for an infantry CV. Yeah, for sure, indeed. That's a good point. Like I said, that was a good push from Rex at the beginning, securing Alpha, but camping in the town is indeed much less important than camping in those woods and blocking off reinforcements. Because by staying there and not calling out much if anything in the way of reinforcements, he's basically just letting Cranky mass up and dispose of his troops at his leisure. So Cranky earlier on took the square for us, so now he has a pretty solid position. Cranky is a pretty careful player usually. He could be a bit more aggressive. I'd like to see him do some more with his 72 M1 mod. He could be pressuring Charlie or pressuring Foxtrot, and his M1 mod would in both cases be able to provide very strong support. He has a T-55 recon tank, which is also very good for fire support. He's sending a bit of an infantry force. He's sending actually, well, a squad, more as a recon to maybe check if there's anything in here. So Rex very weak on base defense. So I don't think, and almost he has nothing in Charlie either. when he knows his opponent has the square forest. So, oh, I'm sorry, I was blocking my mouth. So, the prospects are not very good. Not very good at all. We're gonna accelerate because I think we've seen the most interesting parts of the match. The rest is probably gonna be mostly a cranky mopping up in alpha and securing the game that way. Sending a CV to capture here. I would have gone with an infantry CV myself, simply because we've seen the MLRS being used to try and do some CV sniping. But in the heat of the moment, you know, that's a pretty small choice. Also, you have not secured this forest. Why are you sending a CV? Is it cranky? No! No! Oh no, I can't watch this! The Royal Marines slay the CV. That's two CVs lost to wandering infantry squads by Cranky. Really need to work on protecting those. Like, you can't send a CV to Alpha if you've not secured the forest, or at least if you wanted to do the cap, you could have sent it here where he has troops. Tisk, 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 my dear Cranky. Tisk, tisk, tisk. Obviously, though, controlling the map is way more important than just killing some CVs, especially since Cranky's still ahead in the tick. And he ended up walking an infantry squad in the Charlytown and killing the opponent CV. I missed that. So yeah, now Cranky is well ahead. And we just killed that transport. Oh, and since it's a stalwart, I think stalwarts have zero armor, right? So it took double damage from the Yikari and the infantry in it. Instantly died. Those that should have been Saxon. At the very least, some of the infantry squad would have survived in Deck Saxon. Of course, they would have been cleaned off by the Eurofighter Typhoon. Why? Why send a Typhoon? There's no planes at all. I think Rex might be scrambling a bit much. So we're cleaning up here. Those Royal Marines are being a pain to clean up by Cranky. He's sending troops maybe a bit too piecemeal to try to secure that. Oh, the opponent moved them in the open and they perished in the open. Did it taking one last transport with them in their rage. So we've got another drop of Paratroopers 90 going in. That's a pretty interesting dropping position. Seems like Cranky might have wanted to send a bit more defense that side after he got surprised once. So we have a dead mortar here. So nice job on on Rex's side of keeping up with the flank pressure and the drops. So got killed by Hawk, and we've got the surrender. And the second match is actually a pretty much of a steamroll, so I think we can skip that. It wouldn't be very, very interesting nor educating. With that said, we have Cranky's second set of matches. After winning against Rext, he went against Morkestrand. He won 2-0. The second match was a DC, but after the DC, actually Cranky DC'd. But he had won the opener, and his opponent surrendered. So his opponent was gracious enough to grant him the win, recognize victory, or maybe he was running out of time. But they do have a first match that was pretty nice, so we can go have a look. I'd say this is a more equally matched game. From what I could see when I checked it real quick. Haven't seen it till the very end, but it was pretty interesting. So we've got a pretty interesting matchup. Baltic Front again from Cranky, his go-to deck, I presume, versus Eurocore. So we have a Battle of the Vroom Vrooms, the fast decks challenging each other. And here's our opener. We've got from Morkenstrand a strong opener on the left side, so probably gonna go either this way or this way, try and cut off Cranky from his plus two. So the early plus two push is very powerful on this map. It can turn against you if you don't do it properly, because it's very far from your spawn, so it's easy to cut your forces off from. So you have to kind of be prudent when you do it. So we've got two aim extends, Crotal, some scouts in the VAB, probably Commando Marine. We've got double scouts in the VAB. VAB T20, the autocannon. Some shock infantry in the VAB, either a Legion or Rima or both. Some infantry in the AMX-13, so most likely chasseurs. Flakpanzer Gepard, the A1 for that sweet, sweet stabilized. No, that's, yeah, the stabilizer. And a mortar. So we've got a pretty light infantry force with some good fire support. No tanks though. VAB with probably Milan 3 going in for the town. VAB with some shocks again, Legion or Rima, and some Commando Marine. Interesting that he's going this way. So is he sending anything this way? Seems like he is. Okay, so we've got some more infantry going there. AMX-13 going there to support. Nice fire support to prevent the enemy from pushing that way with infantry. And go in pretty light, which is pretty typical for this map on the right side. Sending some ATGMs, some more Commando Marines, and an AMX-10 just to occupy this position, prevent the opponent from pushing in. We've got a Panther and a Tiger to help the opener. One thing we will note though is zero tanks. I do not think this is a wise idea. I know we call Eurocorps a motorized deck or a moto-oriented deck, but you really, really give up a lot of initiative when you forego armor. That's something that motorized decks have to trade for. And even motorized decks usually, you know, they run light tanks and they use them because you need that armor to help you push. Otherwise, yeah, sure, you can engage the opponent. You can sneak around and engage the opponent in the woods with your infantry, but the woods, the woods have a finish, have an end. You can't just fight in the woods. Sure, if you occupy this position in Delta, you can pretty much occupy it with infantry and more or less fight exclusively with infantry. But then if the opponent goes in the open here, comes in the open here and cuts you off, you need something to push, to punch through. You need armor. And while you won't see a lot of tanks used by high-level Eurocorps players, you'll usually see key pieces of armor used in key positions, especially the Leclerc. It's very common for the Eurocorps to run a single Leclerc and use that nearly for the entire game as their tank, but it's extremely important to their strategy. As for Cranky, he's gone for a more standard road opener. We've got some Yekari taking this road, so I'm guessing he's sending them to the town. Some infantry in the KT, probably a Jagdpanzer, I-90, super heavy, some fire support from a recon tank, and a very nice Pionpasava mortar, some what's their name? Some spikes, and some more infantry, probably for this side. He also started with an infantry CV with the Hilo, BMP-1 KT and BTR-50 to defend this side. He's gone for a FOB. I'm not sure about the FOB in the BF deck. Like, does he use it that much? I think he could forgo the FOB, because I don't think he uses Arty unless he has the. Well, he probably has the MLRS, so if he uses that, then that's okay. Some defense on the right side. He's going a tad bit heavier than his opponent, but which is pretty fairly common on this side, because you can take control of. You want to take control of this little area here to prevent your opponent from just waltzing through and giving you trouble. So recon tank and spikes are gonna probably overwatch this area somewhere here. And then we've got some recon infantry, probably some Iroquois, yeah, Iroquois, some spikes for the town, and some more infantry to go somewhere around here. Seems fine. Okay, so let's see what transpires from those openers. So one thing we're gonna see is there's no way Morkestrand
can hold the center. He may hold his side of Bravo or this side of Bravo, but he won't be able to challenge Cranky's super heavy tanks. So Cranky is gonna t be able to take control of all these firing lanes, all of this open area, unless his super heavy gets sniped by, say, a plane or something like that. But otherwise, or by the tiger, but otherwise it's pretty safe for him. So he's smoking off in advance and taking positions. So he sent his Jagdpanzer Yukari, a very nice, sending them nice and quickly far into the town, blocking off his opponent's access to the town. Those guys are with the 20 RPM launchers are gonna make short work of the enemy's transports and then infantry. The KD providing support, taking down the Tiger. Ooh, that is a huge loss. Very, very big loss for Morkestrat. This opener has gone awry. Really, 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 really bad. So the loss of the Tiger means Morkestrat has lost a lot of initiative, and he's lost a lot of map control. Especially since he has no armor, the Tiger kind of plays the role of the anti-armor boogeyman for his opener, which he no longer has. So now Cranky has free reign of the town here. He has free reign of his side of Bravo, and he's gonna be able to push Morkestrand out of Bravo at his leisure. He can easily spill into this position here and cut off reinforcements and then assault the plus two. And here, so we can see his troops have gotten intercepted. He was going for a positioning over here. Unfortunately, since his starting troops were not wheeled, I would be very careful to sending troops down here on tracked transports in the opener. Because if the opponent is coming in with wheeled troops, either this way or this way, chances are he'll arrive before you and you'll get intercepted, which is bad. So the Panther is here, Mi-17 is here. Cranky reacting by calling back his 70 TS-72 M1 mod, making sure he can overwatch this area so his opponent can just fast move units in his pawn. We've got some action on this side. Commandos Para and Milan engaging. We've got the AMX-10 engaging and destroying a BTR-50. So, taking down the key RKK. So, yeah, those transports were probably a bit too exposed. Really good play by Morkestrand to go and take this position. This is a really, really annoying position to have taken on you when you're playing this side. It's good to send something this way in the opener, especially when playing against a more moto deck that has like really good harassment units like the MX-10. Sending the BMP-1 KT. Gonna have to be careful with the BMP-1. If it can get up close to the AMX-10, it can often take it out really quickly. But otherwise, the AMX-10 is probably gonna win at max range. Well, of course, because it's got more range. So Cranky is spreading out into the town. I'd like to see him be a bit more aggressive. He has the initiative. He's won the opener. He's taken the center of the map. So when in this position, one, the first thing you want to do is avoid losing. That's good. So you want to reinforce your position. Make sure you don't leave any cracks the opponent can sneak through. But then you want to press your advantage. You want to be aggressive. That's a problem I have. I really lack aggression, especially when I'm in a winning position. Cranky seems to be a bit timid himself. So we have some reinforcements being sent in the woods. Those Yikari 10, the Yikari 90 are gonna do absolutely nothing. They're gonna get taken out by the Rima and the MX-10. So Cranky seems to be in a bit of a panic, sending some piecemeal forces to try and retake Delta. Piecemeal attacks are not gonna retake Delta. It's really, really strongly occupied, and he's seen it. He's seen that there's a lot of stuff that went there. He could see it from the town when he was taking the town. So the opponent here has taken position with AMX-10s, and he can use them to pound and harass the enemy's infantry in the town. There you can have some very nice coverage from the EMX 10s, which would give him a very nice platform to retake the town. So Cranky actually hasn't fortified the town very much. There's no spikes. There are here, but not here. No spikes, just one anti-tank unit, and just a few Yekari. So if you wanted, Morkestrad could walk in here and take the town, which would be important, because if he doesn't control the town right now, he's gonna get cut off. You can't hold Delta without having a presence in the center here. Sure, you can funnel reinforcement through Charlie, but one, that's very slow, it consumes a lot of gas, and two, Charlie is very vulnerable itself if you don't control this area. It's very easy for the opponent to take control of this here and then spill into Charlie. Both two-pointers are really hard to defend. That's like one of the key points of this map. It's very hard to defend your plus two because it's very large and there's a bunch of entry points, and those entry points have cover. So you usually, the way you defend them is you take control of the entry points as much as possible by controlling this whole area here, then here. Then the opponent can't enter your two-pointer, but we're not seeing that from either side here. So right now, Morkestrad is leaving himself very vulnerable to getting intercepted here. For instance, he's sending some supply here, but I think they might be running in the range of the KT. Oh, he detours. They're gonna avoid the KT just in time. I would really like to see Cranky send some spikes, maybe a tank, maybe a recon tank around here. But we've got an actual push coming in. So instead of sending his Yekari piecemeal, he waited for some reinforcements. He's coming in with his mod. He has a recon tank. So this is gonna start to be enough to cause problems for Morkestrad. In particular, the mod is gonna be a pain to deal with. Sure, he's got legions, but as long as Cranky keeps his mod properly screened, he can deal with the legions, and then Morkestrad has no armor to deal with the M1, so he has to rely on trying to ambush it. He's fighting on a very narrow front now. So we're gonna see the M1 being able to absorb a lot of damage. The infantry has taken quite a bit of punishment, but the armor is still there. So Cranky plays it maybe a bit too careful. He calls his super back. Well, at least he called it back to protect it from the Peace Rain. Even if you're fighting in the woods, please give some some smoke cover to your super heavy. Make sure you don't open yourself to get it snipe. I'm not sure why Morkestrad decided to come this way with the Peace Rain. The issue with coming this way is the M1 is facing this way, so it's going to be harder to kill it. He could just cut through the middle and strike it in the side. Sure, your opponent's going to see it coming, but then he has to either turn this way and show side to infantry, or he has to retreat, which he did anyway. In either case, you're probably in a better position if you did that way. So Cranky, after seeing the attempt at siphoning his tank, is probably going to provide some smoke cover. Yeah. And he's gonna start dripping some more troops back in. Morkestrad is setting some reinforcements. We've had some skirmishing on the northern side, but not too much. AMX-10 has been taken out by BMP-1 KT and MI-8 KT. Those two units working together should always be able to take down an AMX-10. Worst case scenario, you lose the BMP-1 KT, but it's there long enough to reveal the AMX-10 and then you can kill it. So we've seen, I think we missed it, but I think there was like a small attempt by Cranky to take this position here. But that was just like a piecemeal attack with some Yekari. Cranky has to watch out for those piecemeal attacks. They're very, very ineffective, and they're ultimately very inefficient. Sure, sending two Yekari to die in like a small probing assault isn't the end of the world, but if you keep doing it over and over again during the course of a game, you're gonna run into the risk of running out of Yekari, and two, well, you're just throwing points away, and those points add up. If you do it three times, that's 30 points times three. That's an M1 Wilk that you could have used to push and actually do some proper damage. So we have a Copa Civi here, very, 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 in quite a bit of danger, actually. And we've got the Peace Rhine coming in, trying to kill some stuff. Where's the T-72? Did the T-72 die? Oh no, the T-72 died. We missed that. He probably left himself exposed to a side shot. I don't think I saw it get killed by the Peace Rhine. Maybe I missed that. I think it probably got killed by a side shot from the infantry. Maybe he pushed a bit too hard with it, unless he retreated it. Doesn't seem like it. So calling in an ASF, floating it. So we've got a big... some nice action here. So despite losing his tank, Cranky is still managing to push very well. He's using his recon tanks as his armor to push in, which is a pretty good choice. Those should deal pretty well with AMX-13s and AMX-10s. They're pretty vulnerable to Rima and Legion, though, so you have to be very careful in how you micro them. They die in one shot to either of those. So given that, maybe I'd like to see him use an M1 Wilk as his supporting armor in here. Or maybe just some more KTs. His deck seems to be kind of low on KTs. From what I can tell, he runs 3 cards of Yukari 90 in the BTR 50, so he relies a lot on his Yukari 90, which is usually often a good bet, especially if your opponent is spamming shock infantry in expensive transports, like a Eurocorps player. This is probably like the best thing you can do against Eurocorps. You're just gonna grind them down. The transports die in one shot to the Yakari's launcher, and they thanks to their above average MG, they're gonna grind down the special forces, and the BTR-50 can provide just enough fire support that it's gonna help you advance very well. I'd say you probably don't want to exclusively rely on that, but if the opponent is just sending you special shock infantry, especially expensive shock infantry, then you can probably, yeah, just grind them out with that, and, you know, maybe some mortar support, some fire support from whatever you have on hand, the BDR-50s, of course. Like here, the BDR-50s plus the Yakari easily dispatch the Rima, and sure, the Rima get to kill the BDR-50, but, you know, who cares? The Rima... 85 or 25 points. Their transport is 15 points. That's 40 points. That's more than the cost of 2 Yakari squads. That's almost the cost of 3 Yakari squads, actually, plus the transports included. And 3 Yakari squads plus 3 BTR-50s are gonna overwhelm one Rima squad with 1 VAB, unless you have a really good positioning and you can stop the you can eliminate the BTR-50s with your VAB. So Cranky reinforcing his plus 2. He has a bit of a tick to win back. The opponent has sent a CV here. He's got a CV in middle, so that means he can get a plus 1 tick going with a CV here. Yeah, Copa. That's good. And still no tanks from Morkestrad. I really don't think I can get behind this decision. I think armor would be really, really helpful to him in this match. Like, even just some... Leopard 2A1s would have been super helpful. Leopard 2A1s are really, really, really good at dealing with Yakari and BTR-50. Yakari 90 can't do much, if any, damage to them. And then all you need to do is shield your tanks from his Yag Panzers and other support troops. So I think even... one Leopard 2A1 would have really, really, really helped him to defend against Cranky pushing back into his plus 2, especially after he lost his M1 Wilk, mod, actually. And we've got an attempt at taking the town from Morkestrad, smoking off the town's edge. I think that's the wrong decision. He has fire superiority. He should be using that. Sure, and plus Yakari are actually pretty good at defending towns. Sure, they're not going to win in close quarter because they don't have a close quarter MG. But Well, even then, now that your troops are damaged, I'm not even sure about that. But yeah, with all these VABs and AMX-10s, he should really, really be keeping the firing lanes open and instead smoking off this side of the town to prevent Cranky's BTRs and BTRs, KTs and KRKKs from dealing damage. So this is an easy mistake to make. One problem, I guess, is this is sometimes the proper thing to do. If you don't have fire superiority, but you have super infantry, you can use that trick to try and take the town. And you see, it's kind of working, because he has like overwhelming numbers of troops, which is what I was worried about. Like I said earlier on, Cranky mostly had like a few Yekaris paying part in here. He seems to have sent some more forward, which is good. But I don't think that's enough to... Oh, and we got a dead squad here. And very good from Cranky, not sitting on his laurels. He's spilling out from his own plus two into the opponent's plus two. Going to go try and gift that CV and take some good positions. This lonely Milan is going to struggle to defend against anything. I don't know if ATGMs are that great here. I mean, they're good for interdiction, but you're often going to be assaulted by mostly IFVs. And, well, I guess, you know, an ATGM against IFVs, if it kills two IFVs, usually it's won its points back. So that's not so bad, but some legions would be really good, of course. Legions are always good. Very few situations where legions are not good. Oh, and we've got a KT sneaking into the into Morkestrand. Base. That's very bad, of course. He has a Flakpanzer Gepard here, so he should be able to deal with the KT, but not in time to stop the CV snipe. So let's pause for a second and look at base defense on both sides, actually. So for Morkestrand, he actually had an AMX-13 overwatching this position, which is good. Prevents the opponent from sneaking stuff from the road. Unfortunately, this map is very large, so you really need something to defend against anything sneaking this way around. Either you can float your own helicopter here, which is usually a very good call for Eurocore, because you get some fantastic helicopters. You can float a Cassiopeia or a Gazelle cannon. Against Baltic Front, I'm not even sure if that's enough. I think the KT's guns are not turret mounted, so that might be in. So a Cassiopeia intercepting it might be able to kill it, but there's always the risk that it's gonna take down whatever you send it its way with its guns. So against BF Baltic Front, given how strong the KT is, it can be a risk to just use like helicopters to defend your sides. So instead, you could have some infantry here, some infantry or some AA here, something with an autocannon, something in the town. And as I said, he might have had something in the town, but against the KT, it's very easy to have too little, because this is a very well balanced unit that melts infantry and small vehicles in an instant. It's ridiculous. It doesn't matter if you're in a town or in a forest. This thing is gonna melt you like a butter, like butter in the microwave. So you need to be a bit careful on that. So, and same thing here. No defense here. We do have a cannon, a Gazelle cannon here, but again, it's very. You have to be careful on those flanks. As for Cranky, very nice having the little KT here. It's gonna help defend against flank attacks. But again, the opponent can sneak stuff that way. And then he's got nothing defending this area, so it's very easy for the opponent to drop and then move around. And he has nothing defending the CV, actually. The CV is in a pretty interesting position. This position rarely gets assaulted, but if the opponent comes in here and he sees you have no CV, then he can just go around and go that way. He's got some defense here, but again, it's very easy for the opponent to drop stuff, say here or here, and then go waltz in here or waltz in here. So I'd like to see a bit more structured, a bit more base defense, a bit more structured flank defense from both players. Unfortunately, Morkestrand is the one that got punished for it this game. It's so unfortunate too, because he actually had a Gepard here, but the Gepard was not in a position where it could protect the CV. The K1 probably, the KT probably went in this way. I recon it probably couldn't have come this way because there's a Kortal in the A1. So now Morkestrand has to recall the CV, which he does, and we now have Cranky pushing up with his forces. So here we again see the amazing power of the MI8 KT in action, just instantly melting light vehicles with its autocannons. Like, forget the fact that this has 42 HE rockets, it's got an amazing cannon. Is the cannon turret mounted? That's the question I was asking myself earlier. Is that thing? No, it's not. Okay, so it's on the sides. At least it's on the sides, so it has to turn to shoot, but it turns very quickly. But this does leave it vulnerable to helicopters that actually have turret-mounted guns. So that would be a way to counter it. So I think the Cassiopeia could take out an MI8 KT, but then yeah, the KT is very maneuverable. It turns around really, really quickly, but it's going to get taken out here. It went a bit too ham. It probably would have been better for Cranky to either recall it or position it for some fire support. Again, helicopters can be really good for attacking, but they're also really good for supporting your assaults. If you just slow hover, like in a position like this, if you slow hover a helicopter here, it can overwatch this whole area, and the enemy's anti-tank weapons can do nothing against it. So it's already autocannons and AA, and to hit it with AA, the AA has to get close, and then it gets vulnerable to your own anti-tank weapons. So you know. It's really good to just, you know, fly helicopters in the opponent's face, but it's not always the proper choice. And savvier opponents often have AA overwatching their back. That way, if you overshoot their units with a helicopter, the AA is going to snag it right away. Stuff like this Gepard here, like a Gepard position here, a position here, because it could easily catch any shenanigans. But that said, the KT is not key to Cranky's assault, and the fact that it's just a 40-point elo means you can afford to take risk with it. Again, it's a very well-balanced unit, you know, so you can get away with a lot when you use the KT. So we've got Cranky pushing up with his infantry. He's got some support from tanks, BTR-50s, which are about to run out of fuel, as they often do. BTR-50s are kind of low fuel units. They don't have a lot of autonomy. I'm really liking the Strelaza here. Cranky not forgetting to bring to push up with some AA to defend himself. Sending some Yukari to take care of these Milans. They should be able to eliminate them, even if they're in the town. One's gonna be down in a second. Maybe push up the BTR-50s to provide some fire support, or get some smoke going. So Cranky successfully defended this position, and now Morkestrand is in trouble, because he's about to lose his +2. Cranky is already taking at +1 thanks to controlling the center. We've got a bit of skirmishing going on here, but skirmishing is usually not very successful on this part of the map. Just sending a couple of infantry squads means they're usually going to get taken out, because they have to run through this open terrain. So it's better to push with fire support. Fire support coming here, or from here. Like, that said, Cranky is very low on defense here, and the Commando Para could win this fight, although they have a... Oh no, now they're going to die. Now they're 100% dead. They were already panicked, and the Yekari are only shaken. So yeah, they're gonna annihilate them. So Morkestrand pushing forward with these troops, getting intercepted by a recon tank. I would really like to see Cranky pushing up this way. There's really no reason for him to let Morkestrand have this position. He clearly owns the middle. And again, at 22 minutes into the game, Morkestrand has called zero tanks, no armor. And we know he's not playing motorized, because we've seen him use chasseurs and track transports, those little guys here. So, you know, again, just you're assaulting Yikari up a hill with infantry. They're in the woods. You're not. Chances are you're going to lose this engagement. The Rima are 2v1ing. You're going to lose this engagement. But if you had if Morgestrad had armor, then he'd be able to push the Yikari away from the woods. Or maybe or even a helo. Helicopter would also work here. Just fire support. Because he probably had some fire support as the transport's coming up this hill. But the problem with this is, as you come up the hill, if the opponent has infantry there, he's going to instantly kill your transports, and he's going to panic your infantry. So you can drop... One thing is you can drop your infantry somewhere around here, and then come around with the transports like this. And then you can shoot the opponent from the sides, which keeps your transports out of range of the opponent's infantry. Also, since the opponent is pushing hard on this side, Morgestrand will probably want to have some infantry in here, or in here, just to prevent him from spilling over into here. Because if Cranky takes hold of this area, then there's basically no way he can get back in the game. And at this point, the game is very, very stacked against Morgestrand. I feel like he's very... The points are very, very... there's a big difference in points on the field for both players, which makes it even more frustrating to see Cranky not pushing him out of this position. There's no reason why he wouldn't. Sure, he's being prudent, but now this is being too prudent. This is prolonging the game needlessly. He could be pushing here, pushing here, pushing here. He's pushing a bit here, that's good. Or at the very least, he's trying to push his opponent out to prevent him from making more headway. But especially on Punch Bowl, once you've taken control of these central areas, it's very easy to pressure these areas. You don't need to go like all out and like do or die. That's probably not the way to go about it, because it's very easy for the opponent to reinforce the woods. But you can at the very least push him out of the woods edge. Make sure he can't take positions at the edges of those woods and take positions in here. And once you do that, you have free reign over this entire area, and then you can cut him off from his plus two, and you've won. That's if you take control of this area as this side of the map, then you've won. And it's actually, I'd say, easier for this player to take control of this position than for the other side to take control of this position. But in either case, from this side, if you take control of the town of this town here, then you probably want to try and push the opponent out of this position, and then you can cut him off from his plus two, and that's really bad. If you cut the opponent off from this plus two from his spawn, then it's almost guaranteed you're gonna win, unless they're like push through and kill you at your spawn. So Cranky taking control of the opponent's plus two. He could close out the game by capping it, but there's probably no need. He's ticking at plus three. We've got the loneliest commando para mourning the loss of his squad. We've got some BTR-50s running out of gas. We'd probably like to see Cranky refuel them. Or rearm these... Oh man, these Yikaris, they used up all of their M72A4 law ammunition. This is bad. We've got 20 points of infantry, and they've been allowed to shoot 12 rockets, 12 rockets at ground units, and we know the opponent here has at best 3 front armor units, and most of them are 1 front armor, the KT, the VABs. So we can be fairly certain he's killed something like maybe 8, 5, 6. Vehicles with that. This is this is bad. So yeah, would really have liked to see Morgestrand use armor in this match. We've got a Patu Tiger to overwatch this assault, but just infantry and light fire support is gonna struggle at some point. Well, for one, the Eurocore package of shock infantry plus fire support, with a bit of screening infantry. He did have a bit of screening infantry, although it was still a bit expensive since it was Chasseur 85. This package actually does not deal that well against massed line infantry. It can get overwhelmed really quickly because the shocks are pretty expensive, the transports are pretty expensive, and they're fragile. So it's very easy for the opponent to take them out, either with their own fire support or with their infantry. So it requires a lot of micro on your part to actually successfully beat the opponent in this situation and push him out. And if you're pushing in into a deep forest and you can't provide fire support properly, then you're in even bigger trouble. And we have the game closing out at 500 points tick. Like I thought, Cranky was very far ahead in points. The points were probably pretty even until about the point where Cranky pushed Morkan Strad out of the +2. But then things started going downhill. And one of the biggest issues, again, I can't stress this enough, no armor. Very little armor, and I guess not as much helo support as I would have liked to see from Eurocore, but helo support is more optional, but no armor, not at all. And it's not like Morkan Strad doesn't have any armor in his deck. He has it. He has the full package. He has Leclerc 2A4 and 2A1. Any of these tanks would have done wonders for him. They would have given him so much more gas to push forward and keep on going. Because the problem with cheap fire support and infantry is when you lose fights, you probably lose everything. Whereas when you have tanks supporting infantry, very often if your infantry dies, you can retreat with the tanks and then come back. So you get to keep your tanks for much longer, and you get to extract more value out of them, which is much harder to do with lightly armored units. And tanks have just have a different target profile, and they're not as vulnerable to the same things. Those were some pretty good matches. Pretty well played by Cranky Toaster. I feel like he's, even though he's pretty rusty and he's mostly just played in tournaments recently, I feel like he's handling himself pretty well. I'd like to see him be more assertive in his matches, push his advantage harder, especially when playing factions like Baltic Front, which are very aggressive in their nature. I'd like to see him do less piecemeal attacks, be more, maybe work more on having an idea of what constitutes kind of a minimal payload of units to attack a certain kind of strong point, like a pair of Yakari with their accompanying BTR-50s is not going to be able to take a town away from Eurocore. Even like a single Legion 90 is probably going to be able to take them out. Unless you micro them really, really, you micro your troops really, really well, and like you have mortar support, etc. Then I'd say, if you're going to use a FOB in Baltic Front, I guess he's been refueling his helicopters pretty well, but if you're gonna use a FOB in Baltic Front, you might as well use the MLRS. I mean, it's basically like a Finnish Plamen, isn't it? So if you're gonna have a FOB, you know, have something juicy to resupply. It doesn't hurt that it's one of the best MLRS in the games, that actually synergizes really well with your very aggressive, in-your-face playstyle. And then apart from that, maybe from Cranky's side, T-55 recon tanks are really strong, so it's really good to spam them. I think that's not necessarily a bad choice, but for forest fights, they can be a bit fragile. You probably want to call in some beefier armor for fire support in forest fights. I think a pair of M1 Wilkes, T-72 M1 Wilkes, or even M2 Wilkes would have been really, really, really strong in pushing the opponent out of this S+2. Probably M1 Wilkes, but M2 Wilkes are really versatile. M1 Wilkes are more specialized, but they're very good for forest fighting and stuff like that. Or even more Charioteers. Charioteers would also have been pretty good, although Charioteers die in one hit to Rima. So, especially against Eurocore, if you see he's using a lot of Rima. And Charioteers also, Charioteers also die in one hit to Chasseur 85. So yeah, probably not the best of IDs. You probably want something that at least doesn't die in one hit to Chasseurs, and ideally doesn't die in one hit to Rima. If you can have something that doesn't die in two hits to Rima, that's even better. But that would be, let's see, Rima have 23 AP, I think. Rima 85, of course. They have 23 AP, 23. Heat 23 is the command. Oh, heat 23. So you die in two hits from 15 armor. So yeah, 16. So in this case, maybe the M2 Wilk is actually better. Because the M2 Wilk doesn't die in two hits to Rima, because it's got a... It's got 17 armor. Does 17 armor die in one hit, in two hits from legions? Get legion 90. Oops. Heat 20. Oops. Oh, 17 armor dies in two hits to legions, though. Oh, that's unfortunate. So... And the M1 Wilk with 14 armor dies in two hits to Rima. So you have to be careful when using it. But it would, especially against the Chasseurs, it would be really good. And it would be very good against the Vabs. You do have to be careful to screen it properly, but screening is something you have in ample quantities as Baltic Front. So, you know, you can afford to engage their Rima with your Yekari, and then maybe wait for them to be panicked or close to getting to being stunned, and then you engage them with your M1 Wilk, or you wait for him to engage you with his fire support, and you engage his fire support with your M1 Wilk, something like that. But yeah, I'd like to see maybe a bit more armor used in forest fights from Cranky. In any case, the M1 Wilk at least survives one hit from Rima, which the T-55 recon tank does not, and it's a pretty expensive tank, so you don't want it to trade it for a Rima. And it dies. It doesn't die in one hit to Chasseurs 85, at least. But that's it, pretty much. Those were the matches I wanted to cast for today. I hope the cast was interesting. I don't know if it was too slow, too in detail, not in detail enough. What do you like? Are my opinions wrong and bad? Are they dumb? So do you want to hear less of them and have more just play-by-play reactions? Would you like me to dig more into play-by-play analysis? I really like analyzing stuff, but I don't know if it's really that great. So do let me know what you thought of it. And thanks for watching, and I'll catch you next time. See you.